Starship almost ready and Bigelow Aerospace a fitting payload. My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? As always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry, so let's dive right in. Starship almost ready. This is the final stretch, the last stint SpaceX is on before the presentation, and this means crunch time. Work at the Boca Chica shipyard is going on around the clock right now, and lots of progress is being made on all fronts. First of all, SpaceX right now is fixing a major problem the site had until now, a real bad internet and power connection. SpaceX is finally putting a brand new fiber cable into the ground, laying the foundation for a 21st century broadband internet connection capable of dealing with the huge amounts of data involved in the prototype tests. And SpaceX got another real large piece of infrastructure. A huge methane tank has arrived at the launch site, upping the capacity of the fuel farm. The orbital prototype will consume a bit more propellant than the Starhopper did. So this is very much needed and another indicator for launch preparations. This might be a part needed to lift the Starship prototype into another position. After all, it will have to be moved to the launch site after it's finished, which will be really interesting to see. Now let's get to the really interesting stuff. This is a fillet for one of the fins to be attached on Starship. These will be the missing piece between the Starship fuselage and the fin itself, to make it more aerodynamic. As you can see, these parts are slightly bent on one side, so they will be attached directly to the round hull on the sides of the tank section. The angle suggests that they will be attached at a 360-degree angle on the hull, meaning that Starship will have angled fins as in the original concept. This fin looks strangely small, so my guess is that this will be one of the canard fins attached to the fairing section. We will see rather soon. SpaceX has already started putting the CH4 pipes for fin actuation on the fairing as well, so it should just be a matter of hours or days before we see the canard fins being mounted. On we go. As predicted in an earlier episode, there will be 6 separate landing legs, giving Starship a stable base for landing. Otherwise, there would just not have been enough landing legs, considering that the far smaller Falcon 9 booster even uses 4 legs for a stable landing. And that's not all. They've made great progress in mounting the fins as well. They were lifted up to the sides of the tank section and attached with triangular-shaped hinges. We're more and more seeing what Starship will look like when it's finished. As you can see in this picture, stabilizing girders have been attached along one side all the way from top to bottom of the tank section. These are on the other side as well, where the fins will be attached. If the original concept of the skydiving Starship is still pursued, that would make perfect sense, as the fins would inflict a lot of force on the body while supersonic wind is pushing against them. These are the flap hinge aerodynamic covers that will cover up the flap hinges to make them more wind slippery. I am a huge fan of the shiny metal look. On a production Starship, where the hull will most likely be much more smooth, this will look just awesome in the evening sun. 3 Raptor engines have arrived in Boca Chica and are most likely already mounted under the tank section. As you can see in the picture, the latest Raptor version, presumably serial number 10, has had quite a few changes already compared to the serial number 6 we saw in action on the last 150-meter hopper flight. On we go to the nose cone. It has been attached to the newly manufactured upper ring, and this time it fits much better than before. It's still not perfect, but we're getting there, and the nose cone together with that adapter ring will soon be attached on top of the fairing section. Then only the canard fins are left on the outside together with some landing legs on the tank section. Elon Musk also said on Twitter that the fairing section on the orbital prototype will house a header tank, batteries and other heavy equipment to make it more nose heavy. This tank most likely then is one of the header tanks to be installed in the fairing section. This is most likely not everything you might have seen over the weekend, and it was insanely difficult to follow the fast progress and have everything in the video. So apologies in advance if there are important things missing. I will do another last minute update on the progress on Thursday's episode, so keep an eye out for that. But what about it? What would this look like? Do we have enough information to come up with an educated guess on what we'll see at the presentation? I'd say yes, so let's see what all this put together would look like. Let's start with the tank section. We're still missing legs and engines and probably a few more details. We still don't know what the legs will look like, so this is just a placeholder until we know the finished version. Now, what if we stack the fairing on top? You get your first idea of how extraordinarily big Starship will be. Now let's put that nose cone on and let's attach the differently looking canards to the fairing. One more on the other side and we're done. Is this Starship? What do you think? Elon definitely was right when he said that the Tintin look was gone in the latest version. Elon said that the third fin would be used for landing and not for in-flight stabilization, and we now have separate landing legs. Still though, this is a very unusual rocket. In fact, I'd say that this is something different. It's a special category just like the Space Shuttle was. Where Falcon 9 uses grid fins to control its descent and only for the booster, Starship and Super Heavy will clearly be a two-component system. A SpaceX booster in much bigger and a highly versatile upper stage slash lander slash exploration vessel. Attach a canard arm to it and you have a space shuttle. Leave the fairing door out and you have a crew transporter. Leave the payload section out and you have a tanker. This reminds me a lot of how modern car manufacturers build different cars. They're all based on the same platform. To have the hatchback, you add a different body. You fit in a different engine that attaches to standardized mounting points and you put in a different cockpit. But the chassis under all that stays the same. If SpaceX wants to do something like this, Starship would be even more revolutionary. You could manufacture them from different modules. Need a satellite delivery system? Use the fairing with doors. Need a crew transporter? Use the fairing without doors and with life support and cabins. Want to go to the moon? Add a cargo section with less crew compartments and put an outer door in with a crane to unload on the surface. Incredible possibilities, and we're absolutely close to seeing it at least finished on the outside. Hopefully, Elon will enlighten us with lots of new details at the presentation. I can hardly wait for it, and I'm pretty sure you feel the same. I will be streaming the presentation, by the way. The plan is to start the stream 2 hours prior to the presentation and do some speculation about what we might see. And then we'll watch the presentation and have another hour after the presentation to speculate some more on what we just saw. So make sure to mark the date and drop in on the stream, the more the merrier. Bigelow Aerospace B330, a fitting payload for Starship. But what to do with a launcher as big as Starship? I often get comments under my videos from people asking me what such a big launcher could be used for. If Falcon 9 wasn't enough for today's use cases, and what you could possibly want to get into orbit that actually would utilize 100 tons of payload capacity. And these comments seem correct at first thought. A modern telecommunication satellite does not need such a big fairing. The ISS is finished. Starlink satellites are small, right? But think about it like this. If you have a shovel and an axe, you can build a cabin in the woods. But what can you build with a 50-ton excavator and a crane? Right, the Empire State Building. A huge thank you goes out to Perry from Australia, aka Fragomatik, who kindly let me use his awesome animation. If you are interested in more, be sure to check out his channel, link is in the description. One possible use case for Starship would be Bigelow's inflatable habitats. The B330, for example, developed and built by Bigelow Aerospace as you watch this episode, is a modular and extremely versatile habitat for all sorts of use cases. It's been mentioned as a space station module, a moon base, an attachable module for spacecraft, and a Mars habitat. Its unique design is based on a very smart idea. It basically works like a balloon. In its initial state, the whole module is crammed into a relatively small box. This way, it takes up significantly smaller space in a rocket fairing than a traditionally pre-built station module for the ISS, for example. Once in space and docked to its destination, onboard gas tanks start to pressurize the inside, inflating it and bringing it to its full size. This way, incredible module sizes can be reached. The 330 in this module's name stands for the 330 cubic meters of pressurized space inside. In comparison, the ISS Destiny module has a pressurized space of 105 cubic meters and weighs 15 tons. The B330 weighs only slightly more at 23 tons but offers more than 3 times the space. And a Starship, in theory, could bring up 4 of these, bringing more pressurized habitat into LEO than the entire ISS in a single launch. Recently, NASA started some in-depth tests of the B330 at the company's headquarters in North Las Vegas. Bigelow Aerospace is in a group of companies funded by NASA to build possible habitat solutions for space and a possible moon base. And these tests are part of the evaluation process. Conducted by scientists and real-life astronauts, B330 has been tested for a few days. Positive and negative aspects have been collected and given back to Bigelow for feedback and further improvements. Bigelow already has a module attached to the ISS. It is called Bigelow Expandable Activity Module, or BEAM, and was brought up to the ISS on board CRS-8's Cargo Dragon in 2016. Since then, it's been tested and used as cargo space on the ISS, and NASA has already extended its stay until at least 2020. In July of this year, an engineering assessment certified BEAM's ability to remain attached to the station until 2028, as it has exceeded performance expectations and become a core cargo storage module on the volume-constrained station. Though a contract extension will still be required to allow BEAM to serve out its extended operational lifetime. And this is not all. Bigelow has far bigger plans for its modules. Its largest concept, the BA2100 or Olympus module, would be more than double the size of the ISS in a single module and weigh between 65 and 70 tons. And these are the things Starship could be used for in LEO and even beyond if you refuel a Starship in Earth orbit. These modules could set up a rather large base in a single mission. Keep that in mind when you think about use cases for a Starship. The bigger the rocket, the bigger the mission scenario. So this wraps up today's episode of What About It? What do you think Starship will look like? And will we one day see a BA2100 on a Starship dwarfing the ISS in a single mission? As always, tell me in the comments. Here we are again in our segment for the patrons that help to evolve What About It with funding and ideas. We've accomplished many things together and I'm very sure there are many more to come. As always, we have more patrons to welcome to the team. Everyone, please give a warm welcome to the new patrons. Thank you for watching this episode of What About It? If you liked what you saw, remember to like and subscribe, as this helps me the most. Feel free to hit me up on my Patreon page so I can get additional help in doing more and better content, as this gives me the time to focus on what I love doing the most, to give you the latest and greatest about space and science. I hope to see you on the next episode. Until then, have a great time.
What is that? What is it? I got something in my eye. Oh no.
Even beyond, this way it takes up significant. But what about it?
Yeah, right, no.
While the super fins, yeah.